says, for unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. His name shall be called Emmanuel, God with us, the root and offspring of David, the Lamb of God, the Good Shepherd, the Arm of the Lord, the Rock of Ages, the Cornerstone, the Author and Finisher of our faith. His name shall be called the First and the Last, the Beginning and the Ending, the Alpha and the Omega, the Creator, the Great I Am, the Holy One, the Way, the Truth, and the Life, the Redeemer, the Savior, my Lord and my God, Lord of glory, Lord of lords, King of kings, the Almighty God. His name is Jesus Christ. Neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved.
Good morning. Grasp the heights Well, good morning, everyone. Welcome to our services here at East Frankfort Baptist Church. We're really, really glad that you decided to come out and worship with us and all those who may be watching online. Howdy do up there. We have several announcements this morning, so get ready. Here we go. The men will be cooking breakfast on Mother's Day again this year. Breakfast will be at 9:45, and there will be no Sunday school. Men, please sign up on the opportunity table if you're available to help cook or clean up. So sign up out there today. We will also have baby or child dedication services on Mother's Day. If you'd like to dedicate your child, please see Brother Kyle by May the 8th. A new ministry is starting up here, a couple of them actually. The first one here is the weekly men's breakfast. If you'd like to meet up with a bunch of God-fearing men, sign up on the opportunity table if you'd like to do this. Plan to meet at local restaurants for breakfast on Monday through Friday. So sign up if you'd like to participate in that. Okay, here's one that's been in the works for quite a while. Our East Frankfort Clothing Boutique is opening this Tuesday, May the 7th. Currently, the boutique will be opened Tuesdays from 10 until noon, and on the first Saturday of each month from 10 until 2, and it's by appointment. And we need volunteers, so if you can got some free time on Tuesdays or Saturdays, Chastity would love to have your help in ministering through clothing to the needy here in our community. Saturday, May 11th, from 3 to 5 p.m. here at East Frankfort Baptist Church, there's going to be a birthday retirement celebration of Miss Jewel Mathers. So if you'd like to participate in that or give gifts or whatever, any more details, see that young lady right there, April. She will give you the skinny on it. We give a lot of money to the cooperative program here in the state of Kentucky. If you'd like to see how some of that money's spent, you can do that on May the 14th down in Richmond at EKU at 9 o'clock. They're going to be going to different cooperative program entities. They're going to give you a free lunch. If you'd like to do that, need to get registered, you need to see Don Douglas back there in the sound booth to get set up for that. We need to register so they'll know how many that are going. Okay, Brother Ed is not here today, so I am your backup scripture reading guy. So if you've got your copy of God's Word, if you'd turn with me to the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 2. 1 Corinthians chapter 2. If you're using your Pew Bible, it's on page 1013. So 1 Corinthians chapter 2, we're going to be reading verses 6 through 9. Some really, really good stuff in here. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verses 6 through 9. It begins, "However, we speak wisdom among those who are mature, yet not the wisdom of this age, nor the rulers of this age who are coming to nothing, but we speak the wisdom of God in a mystery, the hidden wisdom which God ordained from the ages for our glory, which none of the rulers of this age knew. For had they known, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. But as it is written, eye is not seen, nor ear heard, nor have entered into the heart of man the things which God has prepared for those who love him." Let's pray. Father, we come before you this morning just thanking you so much for the opportunity to come here and sing praises to your name, for you're so worthy. And Father, we just pray that if anyone is here whom the Holy Spirit is dealing with, that Father, today could be the day that they choose salvation, Father, through Jesus Christ. For as the word says, eye is not seen or ear heard, or has it even entered into our heart, the wonderful things which Jesus Christ has planned for those who love him. Father, we just pray that everyone who hears this, Father, will turn to Jesus Christ and away from their sins. For we ask it in his precious name. Amen.
You stand and worship with us some more.
Thank you.
closer than a brother. There is no judgment. Oh, how he loves me. I got a friend. He is my strength. He is my
Father. Frankfort.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we come before you. We thank you for this day. We just thank you for the opportunity that we have to worship you. In this setting, we know many of our brothers and sisters across the world, although they gather, they don't have the freedoms that we do. And we just thank you for that, for this opportunity we have to gather together. And as we come and we give of your tithes and our offerings, I pray that you would bless it in the furtherance of your kingdom. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
If I told you my story, you would hear hope. It wouldn't get gold. And if I told you my story, you would hear love and never gave up. And if I told you my story, you would hear life, but it wasn't mine. And I should speak, then let it be, of the grace that is greater than all my sin. And when justice was served, and with Jesus' mercy went all the kindness of Jesus that draws me in. Oh, to tell you my story is to tell of him. If I told you my story, you would hear victory over the enemy. If I told you my story, you would hear freedom that was won for me. And if I told you my story, you would hear life overcome the grave. That I should speak, then let it be, of the grace that is greater than all my sin. But when justice was served, and where mercy wins, all the kindness of Jesus that draws me in. Oh, to tell you my story is to tell of him. This is my story. This is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story. This is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. For the grace that is greater than all my sin, of when justice was served, and where mercy wins, all the kindness of Jesus that draws me in. Oh, to tell you my story is to tell of the grace that is greater than all my sin. Of when mercy was served, and when mercy wins, all the kindness of Jesus that draws me in. Oh, to tell you my story is to tell of him. Oh, to tell you my story is to tell of him. This is my story. This is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long.
Well, thank you, Tommy. We appreciate that. Excellent, excellent. As always, thank you, worship team, for leading us so well. I really appreciate each and every one of you all. Well, since we finished the Sermon on the Mount and before we start anything else, we find ourselves just looking at a few verses here and there as a means of just seeing what is it that people are searching for. Of all the verses in the Bible, what are the most prominent ones? And we looked at the most prominent one last week in John 3:16. And we want to look at another one that is ranked rather high, and that is Romans chapter 12. So if you have your Bibles, please turn to Romans chapter 12, and we'll look at two verses. I know we said one, but you'll find both of these verses in the top 20. So why not just go ahead and put them together, because that's really what people are doing, is they are looking at these two verses are often put together. With that, if you will, stand with me out of reverence for God's holy word. We'll read what I'm sure is a familiar passage to many, if not all of us. Paul the apostle writes under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, verse 1, I appeal to you, therefore, brothers, by the mercy of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Our Father, I ask, as always, that you would be so kind as to open our entire being, that we would become more like you. We are embodied beings, body and soul. So transform us from the inside out, that we may conform to the image of the resurrected Savior. And Lord, may I decrease so that you can increase. In the name of your Son, we pray. Amen. May you be seated. I'm willing to bet you have worked at a job that required a dress code of some sort. I certainly have worked several jobs like that, and I did a little bit of Googling this week at some well-known dress codes of certain companies. For years, it may be come to surprise as many, but for years, considered one of the most strictest dress codes of all the companies was Walt Disney. When Disneyland opened in 1955, men were prohibited, they were banned from having any facial hair. And it wasn't until the year 2000 men were allowed to grow mustaches, which if I did that again, my wife would divorce me. And it wasn't until 2012 that beards and goatees were allowed. And as of 2015, soul patches, right, hippies? You remember those. Soul patches were still banned. Now, if you're wearing a big, I don't know, Tigger costume, I don't know why you can't have a beard, but nevertheless, that dims the rules. I enjoyed Abercrombie and Fitch. For those who don't know what that is, you're a boomer. And I'm a millennial. Like, if you were Abercrombie and Fitch, you were in the cool class. I was never in the cool class. But employees wearing a denim shirt, for example, must pop the collar and unbutton the top three buttons. I've never seen anyone other than Elvis be able to pull off a popped collar, but maybe that's just me. If you were to wear a woven shirt under a sweater, let me just pause there for a minute, not to sound like a stereotypical dude who knows nothing about fashion. I have no idea what a woven shirt under a sweater is. I hope you know what that is, and this will make sense. But if you were to wear, as they call a woven shirt under a sweater, the sleeve should be cuffed at half an inch and slightly visible. I have no idea what it is that we're talking about here. Also, quote, flip-flops look great with any look. I strongly disagree. And shirts should get, quote, an easy side tuck or an easy front tuck. Let me tell you, if you walk in here with only the front tucked in, guys, you're out, okay? We will accept almost anyone, but the guy that just tucks in the front of his shirt, don't be that guy. Don't be that. Jesus doesn't love you. Okay, we'll move on. But when I worked in retail at Family Christian Stores, I worked at two different stores at two different times. And the first store I worked at in high school, we were basically told to dress for church. I usually wore a shirt and tie, I could wear something like this. And but when I went to the second store years later, whenever we got married, they had a very strict dress code. In short, we had to dress like we were Mormons in training, ready to go out and tell people about their Lord and Savior, Joseph Smith. We had the white shirt. We had the black breeches. Sometimes I'd wear a black tie with it. And only thing we were missing was the pocket protector and the bike helmet. We could have gone representing the Mormon church. It was a very strict dress code. I remember one year we were doing returns, and I was in charge of that. It was a crazy time. I never liked doing returns. My boss told me I could wear anything I wanted to wear because he knew I was under a lot of stress, had a very strict time code to get this done. So he didn't want customers to bother me, and I thought, great, I didn't have to dress like a Mormon. So I wore a bright red The Ville shirt, and I loved it. And wouldn't you know, that was the day someone from home office drove all the way down from Grand Rapids, Michigan to Louisville, Kentucky to fire my boss. And here I was, the floor leader of the day, in my Louisville shirt. Verily I say unto thee, that did not get me any bonus points. Nevertheless, such policies are in place because how we present ourselves to each other, to customers, or whatever it may be, really does matter. It is a reflection not just of who we are, but who we represent. There's a reason why Walt Disney wanted his employees to look a certain way, because they represented him. How we present ourselves matters. The same is true when it comes to our faith. I want you to note here in these two well-known verses, the key word for both verses is the word found there in verse 1, to present yourself. How we present ourselves to the Lord, how we present ourselves to one another and to this dark world is important. So two ways we need to present ourselves according to the Apostle Paul. The first way is we must present our bodies as holy. Present our bodies as holy. You'll notice that one of the, if not the first word in your Bible, in your translation, is the word therefore. You've heard me say this before. You've probably heard other people say something like it. Anytime you're reading the Bible and you see the word therefore, you need to ask yourself, what is therefore therefore? And therefore is therefore going all the way back to chapter 1, verse 1. It basically what you have here starting in chapter 12 is a transition from theology to practical living, from orthodoxy to orthopraxy. And so in the opening chapters, Paul indicts all of us as sinners, and then he directs our attention to the hope that we have in Jesus. And in chapters 9 through 11, he addresses the question of the Jews. After all, if we inherited this faith from Judaism, and Jesus is the Jewish Messiah promised in the Hebrew Scriptures, what do we do regarding the Jews and the promises made to the Jews? And all of that is addressed in chapters 9 through 11. But what is perhaps most important is how Paul ends chapter 11. Go over with me to chapter 11, starting verse 33. Paul breaks out in song here. Oh, the depth of the riches and wisdom and knowledge of God, how unsearchable are his judgments, how inscrutable his ways. For who has known the mind of the Lord, or who has been his counselor, who has given a gift to him that he might be repaid? For as him, from him and through him and to him are all things. To him be glory forever and amen. It's interesting, isn't it, how Paul goes from theology to doxology. He breaks out in song saying, don't we worship a great and mighty God? Therefore, I appeal to you, brothers and sisters, by the mercies of God. And so he is calling us there to respond. That word appeal is important. It is the language of urgency. That is to say, Paul isn't simply giving us advice. Rather, he is saying that faith naturally follows in this direction. That when we understand who God is and what Christ has done for us, this is now who we become. So, therefore, he says, present yourselves. This, again, is the main verb of these two verses. Whether we are believers or pagans, our faith draws us to present ourselves in a specific way. But how do we present ourselves as believers? And he says very clearly there, to present your bodies. Now, this is a surprising message for us to hear, particularly from Paul, but not just us today in the 21st century postmodern America, but for Paul in first century Greco-Roman world. After all, he's writing to the capital city of the nation as we live in the capital of our state. Now, this idea of presenting your body sounds strange, but it is essential to our faith. Because the ancient Greeks, the Greco-Romans, they bifurcated a body and soul. They would say that the body was bad, the soul was good. Now, that can manifest itself in a number of ways. Sometimes they would say, what I do with my body doesn't matter, it's what I do with my soul. Others would say, well, the body is bad, therefore anything I do with the body makes me therefore bad. And this is where you get asceticism and other stuff. And so they could understand Paul saying, present your souls to God. They could never have fathomed why anyone would say, present your bodies to God. After all, your body, the flesh, is a bad thing. Now, if this sounds weird to you, it's because you haven't been paying attention to the world in which you live in. We believe the same thing. We may not use the same language, but it's still the same pagan belief. Let me give you a few examples here. There is a quote attributed to C.S. Lewis. He didn't write it. In fact, he wrote the opposite in Mere Christianity and other writings. But he gets credited with it because it sounds like something he would write. It comes from someone who doesn't know anything about C.S. Lewis. But nevertheless, it is this. You don't have a soul. You are a soul. You have a body. You ever heard someone say something like that? Or let me share with you, one of my favorite bands in all the world, still going on, is a band called Switchfoot. They're from California. Don't judge them too harshly. Well, without a doubt, my favorite song by them right now is a song called Where I Belong. And I love this song. It's about life in heaven. I love it. It's a great song. Until I discovered it's pagan. Right? That was disappointing. Let me give you a line from it. I'm not sentimental. This skin and bones is a rental. Now it works well in the song, but that's not what we believe. Or maybe we can think of it a different way. Have you ever heard someone say, look, I'm not religious, but I'm spiritual. Now, have them define the word spiritual. You can't. Or have you noticed how increasingly we consider our bodies to be the enemy of our feelings? Given that in a secular materialistic world, we don't believe in the supernatural and we don't believe in the soul, broadly speaking as a culture, you can't talk about body and soul, but we do talk about body and feelings. So if I find that I feel a certain way, then I must bring my body in to conform to my feelings rather than my feelings to conform to my body. Right, this is the way, as Christians, we always understood this, that if I felt something that contradicted reality, I needed to change my feelings. But now it's the opposite. If I feel like the reality is conformed to my feelings, reality must conform to my feelings. We are just as pagan as the ancient world. But Paul comes and says, no, you need to understand, we are holistic selves. We are body and soul, not a body with a soul or a soul with a body. We are both. Therefore, what we do with both is important to God. Now, how does Paul want us to present our bodies to God? Two ways. First, as a living sacrifice. Secondly, as a holy sacrifice. Now, these are the only sacrifices God would accept in the Old Testament. That means that you could only present to God that which was holy and spotless. That is to say that he had a lamb or a goat or a bull or something that was handicapped or maimed or sick. You would never, in the Old Testament Bible, you would never present that animal to the Lord. You had a beast that was the best that you had, most perfect thing that you had. You would bring it to God. And this is the sort of thing that got Cain in trouble. Remember, God accepted Abel's best, whereas Cain brought only to God his leftovers. And I would say that we as believers in 21st century postmodern America are just as guilty of this sort of thing. We don't present our best to the Lord. We don't present ourselves as living and holy sacrifices. We so often act like reading the Bible is too difficult. We gather for worship only when it is convenient. We refuse to share our faith because it is too scary. And we manufacture excuses when warring against sin in the flesh because obeying God's command is just too complicated and difficult. We're guilty of this, that we don't present our best to the Lord. But to be a follower of Christ is to give him that which is holy and living. And this requires us to live out our holiness every day. So then, what does it look like practically to present our bodies as holy and living sacrifices? Can I just give you three things? We could look at a dozen, just three, because we're going to try to beat the Methodist to crack a barrel today. First thing is we need to transform our hearts. The Bible is clear that the heart is evil. We have a wicked, wicked heart. Let me give you just a few references here. In Genesis 8, after Noah gets off the boat, we read this. When the Lord smelled the pleasing aroma, the living, holy sacrifice Noah offered, the Lord said in his heart, I will never again curse the ground because of man, for the intention of man's heart is evil from his youth. A lot of people like to point out, God said something like that before the flood. Well, he said it after the flood, too. What does that tell you about human nature? Consider the prophet Jeremiah, which I didn't put up there. The heart is deceitful above all things and desperately sick. Who can understand it? Jesus stated in Matthew 15, for out of the heart comes evil thoughts, murder, adultery, sexual immorality, theft, false witness, and slander. Our hearts are wicked, which means that we need a transformation of the heart. And this is what we get in the Bible. In Matthew chapter 5, Jesus says, blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Psalm 51, create in me a clean heart, David writes in an act of repentance. O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Obviously, here he is talking about not the heart-pumping muscle in your chest, but rather he is saying that who we are on the inside matters and defines who we are on the outside. So if you're going to present your bodies unto the Lord, start from the inside. We spent weeks upon weeks looking at this from Jesus' perspective in the Sermon on the Mount. What good is it that you pray really beautiful prayers, but you are wicked on the inside? What good is it that if you can fast longer than anyone else can imagine, and yet you refuse to forgive your enemies? We must transform our heart. Secondly, we must reform our tongue. Reform our tongue. If both wickedness and righteousness stems from the heart, it will first be made public from our tongues. Jesus stated in Matthew 12, for out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. Later he adds, but what comes out of the mouth proceeds from the heart, and this defiles a person. Now, consider your own life. Are you prone to complaining? Are you a whiner? Are you someone who, doesn't matter how beautiful a day it is, a single cloud can ruin it for you? Are you the sort of person, you just can't control yourself, you gotta complain about something, you gotta gossip about something, you gotta whine about something? Well, that is a reflection of what's going on in your own hearts. Are you someone who expresses with regular ease thanksgiving, gratitude, and so on and so forth? Well, that reflects the hearts. So if we wanted to present our bodies to the Lord as holy and living sacrifices. It will begin in the heart. It will manifest itself in the tongue. And finally, we will have the proper use of our hands and feet. An unconverted heart, an unreformed tongue will result in disobedience and wickedness. But a reformed heart, a transformed tongue, is one who will obey the Lord regardless of our feelings, our wants, our needs, or the pressure of culture. Jesus said this in Mark chapter 7. For from within, out of the heart of man, comes evil thoughts, sexual immorality, theft, murder, adultery, coveting, wickedness, deceit, sensuality, envy, slander, pride, foolishness. All these things come from within, and they defile a person. Notice, if you take that list, there are things in the heart, there are things on the tongue, and there are things with the hands. When we present our bodies to the Lord, we will be transformed from the inside, and that will manifest itself in the words we choose and use towards one another and towards the Lord, and how we obey Him in righteousness. Are you eager to follow the Lord? Are you willing to obey Him regardless of the costs? Or is it only whenever it is convenient and conforms to the will and the way of our culture? Well, let us quickly look at, secondly, we must not only present our bodies as holy, we must present our mind as transformed. Notice it there in verse 2, do not be conformed to this world. That word conformed, I think, is one of the more important verbs that you'll find here in these two verses. In fact, Paul has prepared our minds, no pun intended, for that word, right? Because if you go back to Romans chapter 8, the part of Romans 8 we actually looked at several months ago last year, but this is one of the more memorable parts, Romans 8, 28. We know that all things, for those who love God, all things work together for good, for those who are called according to His purpose. We know that verse well. Verse 9 then adds, for those whom He foreknew, He also predestined for this reason, to be conformed to the image of His Son. You see that all this works together. Chapter 8 is all about the work of the Spirit in the life of the believers. So all this works together so that those whom God has foreknown and foreordained, He will draw us to be conformed to the image of Christ. That is the work of the Holy Spirit in the life of the believer. That's it. That's what we are seeking, to conform to the image of Christ. That is as simple as you can put it, I believe, of what the Christian journey is to be. Then you come into chapter 12. Paul raises this issue again where he says, okay, present your bodies as holy. Let me add, secondly, don't be conformed to the world. You want to be conformed to Christ. You do not want to be conformed to the world. Now, how do we avoid that? Well, we present our bodies to God. Secondly, we present our minds as transformed to the Lord. So rather than to be a chameleon, Paul is calling us to be a Christian. Now, one of the greatest temptations within Christianity is we have a missional desire, which I think is a good desire on the surface. We have a missional desire not to be weird. Have you ever thought about that? We have a missional desire not to be weird. We find a lot of other religions weird because they are weird in many ways. Think about it. We Christians don't have a culture. We don't have a culture. If I were to be called as a missionary to go to a third world country, I would stick out. I would not bring with me a Kentucky Baptist religion, because there is no Kentucky Baptist religion, and that we don't have a language. We don't have a certain dress. We don't have a certain culture to bring with us. What we bring is Christianity. What I would be expected to is to adopt certain cultural norms to be indigenous in order to reach an indigenous people. That's the way Christianity works. So if you were to go, as I did when I was in seminary, to Niger, Africa, where we're in this remote village that had never been reached for Christ, we sang Amazing Grace in three different languages. All of us wore different clothes. All of us looked very differently. All of us come from different backgrounds. All of us had different experiences, but we had one Savior that we could sing about. That's Christianity. It's not the case with Islam. When Islam spreads, it brings with it a culture, Arabic culture, where you must learn the Arabic language, you must learn Arabic dress, you must adopt a Sharia law and everything that comes with it. Judaism is very similar to that. Mormonism is very similar to that. Buddhism and Hinduism, Eastern stuff, very similar to that. Christianity is different. A Christian in Frankfort, Kentucky, is going to look very different than a Christian in Frankfort, Germany. But we still have the same theological foundations. So we want to be missionally a part of the world without being a part of the world. Does that make sense? That's a hard balance to figure out. A lot of the fights within the local church in my lifetime has been over that issue right there. Can you have drums in the church sanctuary without letting the pagans take over? I'll let you decide that for my own entertainment. Right? This is what the worship wars has been over about, hasn't it? What's our concern? We don't want Christianity to be weird. We don't want it to be weird. The problem comes when that becomes our dominant worldview. And this is the flirtation that theological liberalism has that has ruined it. You can go all the way back to Friedrich Schleiermacher and those who come from him. And it really comes down to this. The world doesn't like what we say. Can we modify what we say and teach so that they don't think we're so weird? How do you proclaim the virgin birth in the world that doesn't believe in miracles? How can you say God made the world in a culture dominated by Darwinian evolution? How can you proclaim that about the soul when no one believes in the soul? How can you see how weird we sound now? We are weird. Think about it. You and I believe a carpenter's kid somewhere in the Middle East walked out of the grave. It's weird. It's weird. And so the temptation becomes that what can we do to look and sound relevant? Can I give you a little secret here? If you spend your life trying to pursue relevance, you are publicly announcing you are irrelevant. Because people who are relevant aren't seeking it. I'll prove it to you. Gen Zers. Don't you hate it when your parents try to talk like a Gen Zer? I never forget one time my dad tried to rap. Funniest thing in the world. Now it's funny. But back then it was embarrassing. Absolutely. When parents try to talk Gen Z, it's embarrassing. I mean, guys, we'd agreed. That is totally sus. No cap. Big yikes. If you don't know what that means, you don't have Gen Zers in your house. I have Gen Zers in the house. I still don't know what any of that means. Low key, no cap. But the key to not conforming to the world is to have a transformed mind. But what does that mean? What does it mean to have a transformed mind? Well, he tells us we have to renew it day by day. How do we renew our mind so as not to be conformed to the world? Let me give you, I think I got four here, may have three, I don't know, we'll figure it out as we get there. Here's the first thing. First thing we must do is we must embrace the truth. We must embrace the truth. Look, nothing will distort your mind, body, or soul and stir mental distress like anxiety, worry, and everything else more than lies. Nothing will do it more than lies. Lies about yourself, lies about others, lies about your past, lies about the God you worship. There are a number of spiritual truths you and I ought to embrace and be renewed in them day by day. First of all, God loves you despite your past. Secondly, God is good despite your experiences. And thirdly, God's grace is sufficient despite your feelings. We must renew our minds with these basic truths. Furthermore, the world destroys our faith through constant half-truths and lies. We're constantly lied to about what it means to be human, what is most valuable in life, as well as all the major worldview categories. We're being lied to. This is why we must cultivate in our minds the truth of the gospel and the truth of God's revelation. We must stand on truth and not be tossed to and fro by worldly lies. We must learn to embrace the truth. Secondly, we must practice the spiritual disciplines. In fact, I would say you'll never grow in the truth without the discipline of the spiritual disciplines. You can't do it. You cannot do it. Now, there are several here we could talk about. We've done a whole series on these before. Let's begin here. We should regularly read Scripture and regularly pray to the Lord. This should be obvious because you cannot grow in truth without access to God's truth. You can't do it. We should be concerned that students and adults alike will spend more time looking at reels on TikTok, Instagram, Facebook, and everything else, which are shaping our worldview more than we're allowing the gospel to shape our worldview. What we think about what it means to be human, what we think about sexuality, what we think about truth, what we think about culture, what we think about justice, what we think about government, what we think about right and wrong, what we think about goodness. We are shamed more by what we're receiving through our phones than we are through God's word. That should concern us. It's hard to renew your mind when people are filling your mind with a lot of garbage. In that related sense, we need to grow in the disciplines of meditation and worship. See, both meditation and worship turn our focus and hope away from the self and onto Christ. You realize that you are meditating each and every day. Again, you pull out your telly and you spend hours upon hours reading tweets or whatever it is it might be. You're meditating on something. If you're meditating your free time on the upcoming election, you are not a happy person, nor will you be. But if you are meditating and filling your heart and your soul and your mind with the goodness of God's grace, you will be better off. Worship reminds us of the love of Jesus, the hope of the world, the beauty of Christ. We need these things daily. We also need to practice confession, repentance, and forgiveness. If your past and sin dominate you, get rid of it through confession and repentance. If you struggle with the wounds that others have caused you, learn to forgive and seek reconciliation. Yes, it's hard. Yes, it's convenient. Yes, it may give you the ick to hear it. But you need to learn that until you practice it, you will never be free. But once you are free, you can truly renew your mind in the things of God, who has shown you greater grace towards you than you will ever be required to show others. Finally, the discipline of rest. Some of y'all probably need a good vacation. Some of y'all need to get off your phones and go to bed. Rest is given to us by God. It's right there on the first page of your Bible. We need it. The spiritual disciplines are not just there to give monks something to do, by the way. They are tools for the believer to renew our mind, so as not to conform to the world. Finally, we need to surround ourselves with godly believers. There's an old joke, and I think I've shared this before, about how after you're married for so long, spouses start to look a lot like each other. There's some truth to that. But the truth is, those whom you surround yourself with, you will either be a blessing, they will either be a blessing or a detriment to you. Surround yourself with losers and pagans, and you'll become one. Surround yourself with godly men and women who will lift you up, and you will be lifted up. Be the sort of person that you, yourself, can be an encouragement, a blessing to others. And not only will you be blessed, but you will be a blessing. Surround yourself with godly believers. Now, if only I could think of a place that will have us to regularly embrace the truth, practice the disciplines, and surround ourselves in fellowship with godly believers. Can you think of a place like that? When you think of it, you let me know before you leave the service or text me while I'm searching TikTok tonight. We need these things. We need these things. Yes, we must present our bodies as a holy and living sacrifice, but don't forget we need to renew our minds so as not to be conformed to the image of this world. I remember growing up, in the summer when we weren't at school, and there would be these daytime talk shows on. And they were all pretty worthless. It was either a daytime talk show or a soap opera was the only thing that we had on our five channels. Okay? You had the local news at noon, and that was it. You know, those three things. Batman didn't come on until 4 o'clock. Yeah, that's right. So someone grew up with a good childhood with the Batman reference. Repeating episode that they would get new people on. It was basically the same concept. All these daytime shows was that they would have people volunteer who they perceive themselves as being less than ideal physically. I don't know how else to put it. They didn't think they were very attractive. I'm struggling with the nicest way of putting it. And so the show would then put the worst picture they could imagine of this person up there. And everyone would say, "Ew, look how awful." Like the whole show is this. You remember these shows? And the person would come on and give testimony. Yes, I know that my eyes are crooked and my nose is missing. And they would give all the bad things about themselves. And then Ricky Lake, whoever it is, would come up there and say, you know, we're going to fix this person today. They're going to be beautiful. They're going to be charming. They're going to be all these things. And then the rest of the show is showing how this awful-looking person in their own eyes is going to be made to look like this supermodel. And basically what they did was they loaded them down with spray paints of makeup, fixed their teeth, stuff like that, gave them a new wardrobe. And then at the end of the show, they would parade this person out, right? And they would just have a new walk. They'd have a new smile. They'd have these new looks. And everybody would be like, wow, you were an embarrassment before then, but now look at you. You're wonderful. You're beautiful. And even as a kid, I thought, that's just mean. It's just mean to do someone like that. How desperate are you to be a celebrity to go on a show like that? When you're the one who's, anyways. But I can't help but think that may be an encouraging thing to someone. But eventually the makeup rubs off. You can't afford that fashion. So you're going to have to shop back in the clearance aisle of Goodwill again. And before you know it, you thought you could present yourself a certain way only to discover that's not who you really are. The gospel comes and says you're doing it backwards. Allow Christ to redeem you from the inside. Transform who you really are. And let Him draw you to repentance and faith and action. Let Him be the one that conforms us to the image of the Son. So I don't know who you are or what your needs are today, but some of you right now have been trying to pretend to have everything okay. You've gone to the experts. You've done everything that you were supposed to do, that the books and the internet and the blog posts told you to do, and yet inside you're still off. I beg of you to come to Christ. I appeal to you, brothers and sisters, to come to Christ. Or maybe you're here and your faith is stagnating. May I encourage you, may I appeal to you, brothers and sisters, to present yourselves to the Lord and let Him make you holy and righteous. Well, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Our Father, I ask that you would be so kind as to help us to see the beauty of this text and to apply it to our lives. That we must present ourselves unto the Lord. And how we present ourselves says something about the God in whom that we are worshiping. Lord, often we do get distracted by dress and looks and outward things, but let us address the hearts. That we are called to present our bodies, heart, body, soul, all of our entire beings. And then may we learn to be transformed, to transform our minds by the renewing of it. Help us to put into practice the basics of the faith, that we may keep our eyes on Jesus and not on the world, that we fear the Lord and not the opinions and the complaints of others. May we present ourselves as followers of Jesus and nothing less. This world has enough darkness. May we be a light unto the nations. May you use us for your glory. Draw us to repentance, we ask in this time of invitation. Amen.